generative AI system.
Generative AI.
Putting AI.
Do you really understand what generative AI is and how does it work? Why did it start to produce such mind-blowing results in 2023 and not a year earlier or later? And most importantly, how can you leverage the power of generative AI for your own projects? This video is a part of my content partnership with AI Accelerator Institute, where I will aim to answer all of these questions, starting from the basic concepts and timeline of generative AI to explaining the key model architectures that currently power your favorite generative AI models. Not only that, but we will also build and train our own mini generative AI models like Midjourney and ChatGPT. Let's dive in. First things first, you have to understand the key differences between generative and discriminative modeling. You see, just a few years ago, the AI landscape was completely different. As an AI developer, 99% of the projects that I worked on at that time aimed to differentiate between different classes rather than generate new data. Simply put, the goal was to put toys into different boxes rather than try to generate new toys. Creativity was considered a unique human trait that machines could never achieve. Today, we know that this is not true. And in fact, by observing various generative models, we can even learn something about ourselves. For example, some neuroscientific research suggests that our brains are essentially generative models that continuously generate our perception of reality to most accurately predict the future. Now, let's try to construct the most basic generative AI model possible. Let's say you have a distribution of points on a graph. The first step is to determine the pattern behind this distribution. As you can see, all the points are roughly located within a bounded square. All you have to do is simply pick a new point inside this distribution. Congratulations! You have successfully created your first generative AI model by generating a new sample within a given distribution. So now, let's see how we went from generating a point on a graph to generating images like this. The first generative AI model was developed in 1950s by Claude Shannon, who used Markov chains to generate text that resembled English language text. However, generative AI did not gain any attention until 2013, when the variational autoencoder architecture was introduced. In a paper, Autoencoding Variational Biases, authors showed that it was possible to generate complex images like faces. This period can be referred to as the spark. Following the spark of generative AI in 2013, several new model architectures have been introduced. One of the most notable is the Generative Adversarial Network, or GAN, which was introduced by Ian Goodfellow in 2014. This period is generally referred to as the VAE and GAN era, and it lasted from around 2014 to 2017. Next comes the transition, with a groundbreaking paper from Google called Attention is All You Need. This paper introduced the transformer architecture, which showed that the self-attention mechanism could be used to generate high-quality text, and it started the new transformer era, which lasted from approximately 2018 to 2019. And finally, in 2020, we entered the era of big models. This era laid the foundation for all future generative AI models that we use today. In 2021, Diffusion Models beat GANs on image synthesis, paving the way for models like Stable Diffusion and Midjourney. Around the same time, GPT-3 was released with an enormous 175 billion parameter transformer architecture. This was followed by even more advanced models like ChatGPT, GPT-4 and Llama. The trend over the last few years has been quite evident. Models are progressively increasing in size, and this is expected to persist for the foreseeable future. So now, let's dive into these models' architectures in more detail. First, let's start with a very basic overview of neural networks in general. Any AI model consists of connected layers where each layer contains units that are connected to the previous layer's units through sets of weights. The magic of neural networks lies in finding the set of weights for each layer that results in the most accurate predictions. During the training process, your data is passed through the network and the predicted outputs are compared to the ground truth. The error in the prediction, or the loss, is then backpropagated through the model using an optimizer algorithm that adjusts these weights. This process is then repeated over thousands, sometimes millions of iterations until the network is able to make accurate predictions. Each pass through the training set is called an epoch. So now, let's try building our own mini generative AI models, starting with variational autoencoders. VAEs were one of the first successful generative models. They are essentially two neural networks, an encoder and a decoder. The encoder network takes the input data, like pictures, and encodes it into a smaller format called a latent vector. Latent vector is essentially a condensed representation of the data, like a super short summary of a book. The decoder then uses the latent vector to try and recreate the original input data again. The magic of VAEs lies in the fact that once the VAE is trained, we can simply pick any random point from the latent space and feed it back into the decoder to generate completely new unseen data. Now, let's make our own VAE using the Fashionmanist dataset. The notebook for this video will be in the description. I will go through all the cells quickly and explain them on a high level. For any in-depth questions or clarifications on a specific code snippets, feel free to pause the video, copy the code and consult with GPT-4. I find that this is one of the fastest ways to learn how to code. The Fashionmanist dataset has simple black and white pictures of clothes that are 28 by 28 pixels in size. First, let's get our dataset ready by normalizing and reshaping them. This is essential because neural networks work best when all inputs are less than 1. We'll make a special layer that lets us pick random points from the latent space. Then, we'll build our encoder network. The encoder network will consist of a series of convolutional layers followed by fully connected layers. The final layer of the encoder will output our latent vector. The decoder network then takes this latent vector and tries to reconstruct it back to the original image. The loss function for a VAE is a bit more complex than for traditional neural networks. It consists of two parts, and not only measures how well the decoder is doing at recreating the original image, but also how closely the latent space variables match a standard normal distribution. As I said, feel free to copy this class and chat with GPT-4 for more details. Now, we can start training our VAE. After training, we can use the decoder network to generate new images. To do this, we simply sample a random point from the latent space and pass it through the decoder. As you can see, the generated images resemble the original data, but they are not exact copies. You can also explore the latent space by interpolating between two points. Although the VAE architecture is not commonly used in practice nowadays because it often produces blurry images, it was a game changer in the field of AI, opening the door to more complex models like GANs. GANs also consist of two neural networks, a generator and a discriminator. The generator creates new data, while the discriminator tries to determine whether the data is real or fake. The two neural networks are trained together, with the generator trying to fool the discriminator and discriminator trying to get better at catching the generator's fakes. This cat and mouse game leads to the generator creating more and more realistic data over time. Let's try to create our own GAN on a Celeb A dataset, which contains more than 200,000 celebrity images. First, we load and pre-process our data as before. Next, we will build our discriminator and generator models. The discriminator model is a simple convolutional net that takes an image as an input and outputs a single value representing the realness of the image. The generator model takes a random noise vector as input and outputs an image. The model that we will be building is a bit more complex than a standard GAN, and it is called a Wetterstein GAN with gradient penalty. For this, we will also need a special training class. We then compile our model with the Adam optimizer and also set up a few callbacks for saving model checkpoints, logging the training process and generating sample images at the end of each epoch. Finally, we train our model for a specified number of epochs. After training, we can use the generator model to generate new images. GANs are responsible for some of the most impressive results in generative AI, such as creating realistic human faces or transferring the style of one image to another. Next come the transformers. Transformers have revolutionized the field of generative AI by introducing the concept of self-attention and replacing the recurrent neural networks for sequence-based data such as text and time series. The advantage of transformers is that they are easily parallelized and can be trained on massive datasets. Besides, the self-attention mechanism allows transformers to understand the importance of each word in a sentence, as well as how it relates to other words. This is much closer to the way we write, because the choice of the next word in a sentence is influenced by all other words that you have already written. In this notebook, we'll be training a GPT model on a dataset of wine reviews. First, we load the dataset and filter it to only include reviews that have a country, province, variety and description. Next, we tokenize the data. This involves converting text into a sequence of integers where each integer represents a specific word in a dictionary. This is necessary because neural nets can only accept numeric inputs. We then prepare the training set. For each review, we create two sequences. One sequence is the review itself and the other is the same review but shifted by one word. The GPT models are trained to predict the next word in a sequence given all previous words. We then create a causal attention mask function. This function ensures that the model does not peek into the future words when making predictions. Next, we create a transformer block. This includes a multi-head attention mechanism and a feed-forward network. We also create a token and position embedding layer. This layer adds positional information to the token embeddings to allow the model to understand the order of words in a sequence, which is also crucial to determine the next word in a sentence. We then build the transformer model. The model takes the tokenized inputs, passes them through the embedding layer, the transformer block, and finally a dense layer which outputs probabilities for each word in the vocabulary to be the next word in a sequence. Next, we compile and train the transformer. During training, we use a callback to generate text after each epoch. This allows us to see how the model's text generation improves over time. Finally, we use the trained GPT model to generate new Vine reviews. We start with a prompt like Vine Review US and let the model generate the rest of the review. We can also adjust the temperature to make the text generation more or less random. Transformers are the basis for all language models that we use today, like ChatGPT, Claude, Google Bard, and Llama. And finally, diffusion models are a newer entry in the field of generative AI. They were introduced in 2021 and quickly proved their efficiency by beating GANs on image synthesis. Diffusion models work by gradually adding noise to the original data until it becomes unrecognizable, then reversing the process to generate new data. This process is repeated over several iterations, each time adding noise and then subtracting it until the model learns to generate new data virtually from nothing. The main advantage of diffusion models is their ability to generate high-quality images with great detail. In this section, we'll train a diffusion model on the Oxford Flowers dataset, which consists of 102 flower categories commonly occurring in the United Kingdom. First, we define our diffusion schedules. These schedules determine how the noise is added and removed during the diffusion process. We'll use three different schedules: linear, cosine, and offset cosine. Now we build our model. We will use a UNet architecture which takes as input a noisy image and a noise variance and outputs a denoised image. The diffusion model class is where the magic happens. During training, the model learns to separate the noisy images and to reconstruct the original images. During generation, it starts with a random noise and gradually transforms it into an image. After building our model, we compile it and start the training process. Once the model is trained, we can use it to generate new images. We do this by sampling a random point from the latent space, basically just a random noise, and then reversing the diffusion process to get an image. Finally, we can use our model to interpolate between two different points in the latent space. This allows us to generate a smooth transition between two images. Some of the most popular models that utilize diffusion architecture are, of course, Stable Diffusion and Midjourney. So now that you have a basic understanding of the key generative AI model architectures, let's explore the future of generative AI and how you can leverage these models for your own projects. The future of generative AI is likely to be characterized by three emerging trends. The first one is the rise of multimodal AI. This involves combining multiple modalities such as audio, images, and text to generate new content. For example, although Stable Diffusion and Midjourney are diffusion models, they are conditioned on a text prompt using an additional text encoder that allows you to control the generation process. GPT-4 is also multimodal and can process images to generate text output. Another significant trend is the increased focus on customization and personalization. This is where foundational models and the concept of fine-tuning come into play. Fine-tuning involves training a pre-trained model on a specific dataset or task to make it perform better for your specific use case. This can greatly enhance the end-user experience. And last but not least, AI and machine learning are becoming increasingly commercialized, meaning that as models grow larger and more complex than ever before, only select few companies are able to train and improve them over time. Besides, the competitive nature of this industry prevents them from sharing the architectures and finer details. This means that possibly soon, only big companies will have access to the latest breakthrough model architectures, and we will be simply interacting with them through the APIs. This, of course, has its own advantages and disadvantages. The advantage is that anyone will be able to utilize these models without any technical experience, and a disadvantage is that you wouldn't be able to customize or adjust them like you would with the open source models. So now, let's see how you can leverage generative AI for your own projects. The possibilities here are basically endless. However, there are a few key points you should keep in mind. First, do not start training a model from scratch. As I said before, models are becoming increasingly complex nowadays. It is important to understand the architectures, but creating your own model requires years of experience and experimentation. Instead, you can use existing state-of-the-art models and modify them to suit your needs. So, if your use case can be solved with a pre-trained or commercial model, then simply use this model and fine-tune it if needed. However, if you're planning to develop a completely novel solution that cannot be solved with any of the pre-trained existing models, I recommend getting started on Papers with Code. Papers with Code is a website that gathers research papers and their corresponding code from GitHub and rates them based on how well these models from these papers perform on different datasets. Therefore, the best way to get started with creating a completely novel AI solution is to find the closest model for your use case and adjust it accordingly. You can even combine it with other models using techniques such as mixture of experts, which is apparently what OpenAI has done with GPT-4. In conclusion, generative modeling presents a huge opportunity for businesses and individuals all across the world. Data is the currency of the 21st century. So why generative modeling received so much more attention than discriminative modeling is because generating new data is essentially like generating value for your business out of thin air. In contrast, to derive value from discriminative modeling, you then have to determine and take actions based on the results. If you want to dive even deeper into generative AI, I highly recommend a book by David Foster called Generative Deep Learning 2nd Edition, which covers a lot more architectures in much more detail. However, don't forget that many custom models also require a user interface to allow your users to interact with the model. So, for an in-depth explanation on how to create AI-driven web applications, make sure to watch this video next.